and welcome back to my channel. If you are new here, my name is Caira and I make videos all about apartments in Chicago, some Trader Joe's. This is part two of answering your questions about moving in with your significant other. So if you haven't seen part one, I recommend going and watching that one, or you can just jump into here because these are all new questions that I'm very excited to answer for you. I put a question box up on Instagram and asked you guys to send me all of the questions you have about moving in with your significant other, and you guys gave me such good questions. Thank you. So I'm super excited to answer these for you today and maybe give you a little bit of advice. If you haven't already, please hit that big red subscribe button. I post two videos a week and would love for you to follow along. Let's get this party started. Why do you look so nervous this time?
I'm very camera shy.
Okay. How do you handle if you guys get annoyed with each other? It just never happens. I'm perfect.
No, we're very lenient with each other. We're not easily annoyed. I guess if I was annoyed, we do have hobbies that we do separately. So like if I'm annoyed, you know, maybe I'll just spend some time playing some video games and doing my own thing. And usually by the end of that, I'm over it. I mean, it's usually not that big of a deal in the first place, so.
For the questions I have lined up for this video, I think a huge key part of it is just going to be communication. Through communication, you have to be very careful to not get super emotional about the communication. This is something I had to learn. I was an emotional diva when we started dating, and it's taken a lot for me to realize that the emotions don't help the situation most of the time. It's better to be able to like take that step back and look what is the best thing for us to do in the long run for us versus me flying off the handle and having really strong emotions.
But it's important to say, if you feel those emotions, they're valid. So you gotta, you have to acknowledge it. Like if you're being emotional about something and you're freaking out about the thing, and maybe I'm over here thinking logically, and I'm like, you shouldn't be freaking out. The fact of the matter is you're freaking out. So we need to talk about it. We need to address it from a stance of, we both recognize this problem. Let's work together to resolve it.
Yeah. Say he's really annoying me or vice versa. Use kinder words than you're annoying me. Like that's just gonna be hurtful. But maybe just say something like, all right, this is being a lot. I'm gonna go take some time for myself right now. And I get this a lot because we lived in a studio. I think people think that having time for yourself means that you literally need to be like alone in your space. I could be sitting on the couch with Alex like playing video games 4 feet in front of me, and that can still be me in my own space. If you do get to those points where you're just getting annoyed, it's worth communicating that you just need some time and then separate. If it's something that's like an ongoing annoyance, like maybe your partner doesn't put the seat down, or yours is even worse, you don't put the seat up. It's worth bringing it up and just being like, hey, this is something that really bothers me. I would appreciate it if you could put in a little bit more effort, and don't hold somebody to perfect standards, but make it so that way you're not getting annoyed constantly and they have no idea why. Is one more organized or clean than the other? How do you divide chores?
Everyone's had, or their friends have had, that roommate that they just hate each other because that roommate never cleans up, or they're so dirty, or they leave their dishes out, or they leave their clothes on the floor. All the things that you can't live with because that's just not how you live. You have to realize that when your roommate takes a plate, they eat off of it and they leave it on the countertop, and that's just eating at you. It's grinding your gears. They don't care. They're comfortable with the plate being on the countertop. So you want the plate cleaned and in the cupboard. By you expecting them to do that, it's kind of selfish because they're comfortable with how uncleanly the kitchen is. You're uncomfortable and you're asking them to take action to satiate your needs. It's not that you're wrong, like you're allowed to feel that way and you should ask them to clean it up, but just understand that you're expecting them to do something for you. Be a little humble in that conversation and say, hey, I know it's a bit anal. I really like a clean kitchen. Is there any way we could work together to keep the kitchen clean?
Way to put this that might be a little bit more digestible. There's not a right or wrong way to live, even though you might feel like there is a right or wrong way to live. Like if you've been raised in a really clean household and you keep things really, really tidy, you probably think this is the correct way to do things. But it's not really fair to say that the other person's doing it wrong. So this has just been like a game changer for us, and we don't fight about these types of things, and it's just been really good for our communication. I like things cleaner than Alex. It's not that you're dirty, but he'll let things pile up a little bit more and then does like one giant deep clean, whereas I would rather like keep things tidy regularly. When we first moved in together, I would like nag at him and I'd be like, hey, your clothes are on the floor. Hey, you didn't put your toothbrush away. Hey, your shoes are left out. And I kept thinking to myself, in the time it takes me to bother him and then make him get up and do it, it would take me a quarter of that time to just get it taken care of. And it's not fair for me to hold him at my same standards. That being said, it's not fair for him to completely disregard what I want and my feelings. When there's little things, I'll happily do them because it makes me happy to have the apartment clean. That is something that I want. It doesn't make him happy. He's doing it to keep me happy.
It's not that I really don't care and I just want the apartment dirty, I have like a different threshold. If I was living alone, I would go a couple days, things would accumulate, it would get dirty, and then I would do a deep clean. And then it would accumulate in a couple days and then I would do a deep clean. She can't live like that. It has to be clean every day. Neither of those two ways is wrong. Both of them are clean, hygienic ways of living. What happens is she tries to clean every single day and then effectively I never clean because every single day
it never reaches
my threshold. And so there, other people might be living like that with a partner that they think is just the sloppiest person in the entire world. And that might not be the case. They just kind of are on a different schedule. You're forcing them to maintain your schedule and it gives the perception that they're just super dirty.
Yeah. I think something that we've done that has been really helpful for us is have like designated tasks, which sounds really chore-like and like your parents are telling you what to do, but it has worked really well for us.
It's like designations that we've fallen into. Not like it's you have to do these things.
We
it's
never on, like sat down fringe. And had like a conversation about who was doing what. It was just these were jobs that naturally each of us kind of started doing. Now we know these are the things. So like I cook dinner every single night. I do not want Alex to cook dinner. I prefer cooking. But in return, he does the dishes every night. I know I will never touch a dish. It is not what I do. He does all the dishes. I do all the cooking. Alex takes the trash out and mops the floors. I do all of our laundry and like general tidying up. They're just things we've kind of naturally fallen into. And now because we have that rhythm, I don't feel bad being like, hey, the trash is full. Do you mind taking it out? It no longer feels like a favorite. It's just, hey, this is what you contribute. You don't need to ask me to do laundry. I'm doing laundry.
If one day or one week you just never got around to doing the laundry, it wouldn't be like me stomping my feet, pouting like, yeah, you do the laundry and you didn't do it. I'm angry. You know, I don't know. It wouldn't be as big of a deal.
Yeah. If you didn't take out the trash for a long time and you were just like, yeah, I'll do it tonight. Like I'm super stressed out at work or something. I can take the trash out. It takes me less than 2 minutes. It's not worth causing a fight over something that can be super easily resolved if it just means you're swallowing your pride for like a minute.
Yeah.
How to keep the spark alive when living together.
Oh boy, the spark.
The spark.
It's tough when you're always on top of each other.
And not in like a sparky way.
Not in a sparky way. We're here in this room always. That's a question that I would like to ask some other people also.
Give us advice. Yeah, no, I think the good part is we genuinely like spending time together enough.
It doesn't feel like we're falling out of love.
No, somebody told me this once. I'm gonna get the quote wrong, but it's something like, too many fireworks in the house make the house burn down. I think that's it. Because sometimes like when you are with each other literally 24/7 in the same apartment, we're not going anywhere, it's pretty easy to be like, oh, we've lost so much passion. It's not as exciting. You're laughing, but like whatever. But I think about people who have that crazy fiery passion and you got too many fireworks in the house and your house will burn down. It goes good and bad. So we, what?
We run pretty cool.
We don't have like these like sparky times.
I'm not putting rose petals in the bedroom.
But
maybe I could start buying you flowers more often.
But no, because that stuff doesn't matter to me. We just are always on like a good, constant, happy. It's never this like ebb and flow of like, we have these really passionate, amazing days and then we have these really, really horrible fights.
I'm imagining getting one of those planes to make a heart in the sky.
I was wondering like, why are you looking out the window?
It could fly over Chicago.
Okay, this kind of ties into that, but it's a different question. Ways to mix it up so you don't get bored doing the same thing every night. We do the same thing a lot of nights.
Yeah, I think everybody's in that rut because of 2020. We try to go for walks. Like sometimes we don't really have a plan. We're not going anywhere. Let's put the dog on a leash and go for a walk. That sounds lame and it is, but it's something different. Or go to restaurants.
Yeah, we've been trying to go to a lot of different restaurants or ordering in different food. Because our standard thing is I cook dinner every single night, sometimes we'll order in something and put on a movie we've never seen or just like commit to watching stupid YouTube videos. It's really not that different from our day to day, but right now things are so limited that those little changes can make a big difference. In normal life, we travel. That is our spark. That is when we make the most memories and we really have such serious quality time. And like, that means so much to me. And it's been a really hard thing for me personally to not be able to do that this year before COVID. Personal time with Alex was when we would travel. And it's taken a lot for my mindset to shift and realize that like us sitting on the couch together at night is now, that's our quality time. It's just different because of the circumstances. And travel doesn't have to be expensive. We have had such cheap trips. We did 2 weeks in the Philippines for, it was like 800 total per person, including flight.
We make it work. Also, something that has been really fun is the cooking with Kai. Kyra streams cooking live on Tuesdays and Thursdays at 6 p.m. Central, and I honestly look forward to it every week. And I know that there's probably some of you watching this right now that are also enjoying that with us. I find it really fun.
It's been really fun because it's now a shared hobby, and we didn't really have any shared hobbies before this.
Besides traveling.
Like, traveling and plants.
plants.
That was really our thing. And like, we'd still go to restaurants and whatnot, but this is something that like we both do together that we get excited about. Are you gonna show off a plant right now?
I was just gonna hold one.
That one is the one you choose, the llama? All right, we're gonna continue on. Was it hard at first getting used to each other's habits?
We knew each other for a long time before we started dating, so nothing was that much of a surprise. It'd be really hard for you to do something that bothered me.
Okay, that's nice for him. I am a normal human who gets annoyed by things. I knew the kid for 2 years before we started dating. Three, and there was things that we moved in together and I was like, what? You do what? He doesn't put up the toilet seat. What? Beard hairs? If you are dating a man and this man shaves his beard, I know you guys know what I'm talking about, but it's so gross.
What am I supposed to do?
I don't know what you're supposed
to do. Can they tell me? Like, what am I supposed to do? I gotta get the beard off my face somehow.
I don't know. I don't know the solution.
But I try to get it all in like
the
trash.
You just
the...
clean it afterwards. And you don't always clean it.
I don't always clean it well.
Oh.
I always clean it. I don't always clean it well.
Okay. It just makes my point. But yeah, there's definitely things when you move in with someone that you're gonna be like, what? When we first moved in together, I never drank milk, but the kid straight out of the gallon, mouth to gallon. If I was drinking that milk too, it'd be super gross to me. Luckily I wasn't. There's things you'll learn that you're just like, how do you humanly think that this is okay and possible? Whatever your grievance is, talk to them about that in a kind and understanding way that this is something that they're going to change about themselves for you. So you have to be nice about it. You can't be a dick about it or they're not gonna wanna do it. And just be patient. It's not gonna be an overnight fix. There may have to be some gentle reminders and nudges along the way, but be patient and you'll get there. But yeah, your freaking beard hairs are nasty.
That's why I just leave them on my face.
I'd prefer them there. Did you give each other a heads up about your gross, weird habits?
No, because I probably am not self-aware enough to know which of my habits are gross and weird.
It's so true. No, we didn't. Number one, I don't think I have any gross or weird habits except I pee in the shower. Do I even want the whole internet to know that?
Yeah,
I don't,
you do.
I don't know, but we're here now. I think most people do, but like it's the only thing I can think of.
I also pee in the shower, but, pretty consistently.
If you are fully aware and you do something really weird, like maybe give your partner a heads up. That'd probably be like the nice thing to do just so it doesn't come as a shock. I think you said it best. If someone's gonna have a weird, gross habit, it's gonna be this guy. And he's not self-aware enough to know that it's a gross, weird habit. And you fart so much.
What am I supposed to do? Not fart?
Preferably.
How do I do that? Like start researching gut health or something and like start eating in a way that prevents me from farting?
That would probably be
good.
That's
too much work. I'd rather just fart.
How to not feel bad about needing personal space.
Because if you say, I just need my space, that can feel personal.
Here's another game changer that we've had was knowing that the other person is never going to intentionally do something to upset you and hurt you. We are not perfect. We'd still fight. Like, let me just preface that all over the place. We are not perfect. We are not the perfect relationship. We still fight and whatever. But I know Alex is never going to do something where he is maliciously intending to hurt me. He'll do something on accident sometimes and my feelings will be hurt. This happens to everyone. But as long as I can take that step back and be like, okay, that sucked, but he didn't mean to hurt my feelings. He wasn't doing it out of malice. It makes things a lot better. If you sat there and you were like, I need personal space right now, I would take that as, ouch, like that's super mean. It feels like aggressive towards me. I would be upset. I need to remember, you're not doing this to hurt me. This is just something that you need. But I think the second part of it is there's a better way to word it that doesn't come off as mean.
Yeah, so like, I think a lot of it has to do with how you deliver the message. You could choose words or you could say in a tone or a way or a timing that makes it more personal. Like I wouldn't say, I need my space. I need to get away from you. That'd be personal.
I'd be so mad. I need significantly less personal space than he does. I'm pretty good just hanging out all the time. But if there was a time where I wanted my own space, I'd be like, look, I had a really stressful day today. I just want to go take some time and decompress on my own if that's okay. It's about you, but you need to make sure that you verbalize that to your partner. Otherwise it can feel mean. I'd be really sad if you told me that you need space away from me.
I need space away from you.
Stop.
Look at you, you're sad.
I know. It hurts my feelings. Okay, let's do one more. How to separate space in a studio so I don't go completely nuts, specifically when living with somebody, because it is definitely a mind swap. We went from having a 2-bed, 1-bath house in Arizona to living in a 400 square foot studio together in Chicago. Some things that really helped us was getting good pairs of headphones. If Alex was watching TV or playing video games and I want to be able to watch a show while I'm cooking dinner, or if I'm just laying on the couch or something, I would throw those bad boys in and have my laptop up playing TV while cooking. It feels like I'm listening to it out loud. You're in your own little world. You're not being bothered at all.
Being two people in a studio, it's not the perfect scenario, so you can't expect it to be perfect. Sleeping is something that you have to prepare for. We don't go to bed at the same time, and we don't wake up at the same time. I need to be, of course, aware that she's sleeping and respect that, but she also needs to understand that I'm awake and I need to move a plate or something, and we're in a studio in the same room. She has to not get angry that I did something, and I have to not get angry that she's getting angry. Same thing in the morning. Something that I've had a lot of success with in studios is earplugs and eye masks.
And sleeping with a fan.
And with a fan. White noise.
For white noise.
White noise, earplugs, and eye mask.
I sleep to TV really well, so I would usually go to sleep with my computer propped up with Forensic Files playing, and I don't hear anything. But if he is being so loud, because sometimes he'll just get carried away or whatever, and it wakes me up, then I'll just be like, hey, keep it down. I think he then realizes it's not this thing worth causing a fight. I am literally just trying to tell him to shush to go to sleep. Because when we were living in the studio, I was waking up at 5 a.m., and I was teaching English to kids in China, literally 6 feet from where he was sleeping. I'd be going to bed at 9 p.m. at night, and he'd be going to bed at 11 or 12. You have to be respectful of each other's schedules, and that's one of the hurdles you're just gonna have to figure out and overcome. All right, guys, we are going to wrap up that video here. I feel like we answered like so many questions for you guys. If you have any questions that I haven't touched on in part one or part two, feel free to comment those down below, and maybe we'll do a part three if there's enough questions. But I hope that this helped you. Hopefully you can manage living with somebody and not absolutely wanna rip their head off. If you liked this video, please give it a thumbs up. If you haven't already, please hit that big red subscribe button. I post at least 2 videos a week, and I would love for you to be able to follow along. Also, follow me over on Instagram. I post tons of content. You can keep up with my life over there, as well as question boxes for different videos that I'm doing. So I love your input. And lastly, I now have a Facebook group going, so I'll have that link down in the description box as well. It's just a really great place for us to like be able to have a community and bounce ideas off of each other and ask for advice, and I am loving it. So thank you guys so much for watching, and I'll see you next time. Put it down.
I don't have to.
Please?